बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। अस्सलाम वालेकुम डियर स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम डॉक्टर राजिया। वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द रीनल फिजियोलॉजी। इन आवर टुडे लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द रीनल रेगुलेशन ऑफ डिफरेंट इलेक्ट्रोलाइट्स दैट आर पोटाशियम, कैल्शियम, फॉस्फेट एंड मैग्नीशियम एंड देयर इंटीग्रेशन ऑफ रीनल मैकेनिज्म फॉर कंट्रोल ऑफ ब्लड वॉल्यूम एंड द एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर फ्लूइड वॉल्यूम्स। सो दिस इज द चैप्टर नंबर 30 इन द यूनिट 5। इट इज मोस्ट इंटरेस्टिंग एंड मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर द रेगुलेशन ऑफ और कंट्रोल ऑफ ब्लड वॉल्यूम एंड द एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर फ्लूइड वॉल्यूम। सो टुडे वी विल डिस्कस इन डिटेल द रेगुलेशन ऑफ एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर फ्लूइड पोटाशियम कंसंट्रेशन एंड द पोटाशियम एक्सक्रीशन और सिक्रीशन। सो एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर फ्लूइड पोटाशियम कंसंट्रेशन नॉर्मली इट इज रेगुलेटेड एट अबाउट 4.2 मिली इक्विलेंट। इट्स कंट्रोल इज नेसेसरी बिकॉज मैनी सेल फंक्शंस आर सेंसिटिव टू चेंज इन द एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर फ्लूइड पोटाशियम कंसंट्रेशन। फॉर इंस्टांस एन इंक्रीज इन प्लाज्मा पोटाशियम कंसंट्रेशन ऑफ ओनली 3 to 4 मिली इक्विलेंट कैन काज कार्डियक एरिथमियाज एंड हायर कंसंट्रेशन कैन लीड टू द कार्डियक अरेस्ट और द फिब्रिलेशन। So a special difficulty in regulating extracellular potassium concentration more than 90% of the total body potassium is contained in the cell. As you can see, the intracellular potassium are more as compared to the extracellular fluid volume or fluid potassium. So in a 70 kg adult who has about 28 liter of intracellular fluids, so that are the 40% of the body weight, and 14 liter of extracellular fluid, it contain about 3920 milli equivalent of the potassium are inside the cell and only about 59 milli equivalent in the extracellular fluids, which is about 4.2 milli equivalent. So as a potassium contained in a single meal may be as high as 50 milli equivalent, and daily intake usually ranges between 50 and 200 milli equivalent per day. So if a person can take 100 milli equivalent, in this slide you can see. So maintenance of balance between intake and output of the potassium depend primarily on the excretion by the kidney, because the amount excreted in feces is about only the 5 to 10% of the potassium intake. The maintenance of normal potassium balance require the kidney to adjust their potassium excretion rapidly and precisely in response to wide variation in intake. So control of potassium distribution between the extracellular and intracellular compartment also play an important role in potassium homeostasis, because more than 98% of total body potassium is contained in the cell that can serve as overflow site for excess extracellular fluid potassium during hyperkalemia or as a source of potassium during hypokalemia. Thus the redistribution of potassium between the intracellular and extracellular fluid compartment provide a first line of defense against changes in the extracellular potassium concentration. So for this purpose, the regulation of extracellular potassium concentration is necessary, and for the regulation of internal potassium distribution, you can see here the different factors that can influence the distribution of potassium between the intracellular and the extracellular compartment. The first one is the insulin. The insulin stimulates the potassium uptake into the cell. Insulin is important for increasing cell potassium uptake after a meal. If pupil who has insulin deficiency owing to diabetes mellitus, the rise in plasma potassium concentration after eating a meal is much greater than the normal one. And second are the aldosterone. Aldosterone increases the potassium uptake into the cell, which excess aldosterone secretion in case of Cone syndrome is almost invariably associated with the hypokalemia. Conversely, patient with deficient aldosterone production, as in Addison disease, often have clinically significant hyperkalemia due to accumulation of potassium in the extracellular space as well as renal retention of potassium. And next factor are the beta adrenergic stimulation increases cellular uptake. Increased secretion of the catecholamine, especially the epinephrine, can cause movement of potassium from extracellular to intracellular fluid, mainly by the activation of beta 2 adrenergic receptors. Which are the treatment of hypertension with beta adrenergic receptor blockers, such as the propranolol, causes the potassium to move out of the cell and create a tendency towards the hyperkalemia. And the fourth one is the acid-base abnormalities changes distribution of the potassium. Metabolic acidosis increase the extracellular potassium concentration, whereas metabolic alkalosis decrease the extracellular fluid potassium concentration. Although the mechanisms responsible for effect of hydrogen ion concentration on potassium internal distributions are not completely understood, so one effect of increased hydrogen is to reduce the activity of sodium potassium adenosine triphosphate pump. This reduction in turn decreases the cellular uptake of the potassium and raises the extracellular potassium concentration. And the next is the cell lysis that causes increased extracellular potassium concentration. As cells are destroyed, the large amount of potassium in the cell are released into the extracellular compartment. This release of potassium can cause significant hyperkalemia. And next one is the exercise. Heavy strenuous exercise cause hyperkalemia by releasing potassium from the skeletal muscle. So prolonged exercise can release the extracellular fluid potassium. Usually the hyperkalemia is mild, but it may clinically significant after heavy exercise, especially in patients with treated with the beta adrenergic blocker. Exercise may be severe enough to cause cardiac toxicity. And the last one is the increased extracellular fluid osmolarity causes redistribution of potassium from cell to the extracellular fluid. So increased extracellular fluid osmolarity causes osmotic flow of water out of the cell. The cellular dehydration increases intracellular potassium concentration, promoting diffusion of potassium out of the cell and increasing extracellular fluid potassium concentration, and decreases extracellular fluid osmolarity has the opposite effect. So you can see there are many factors that can alter the potassium distribution between the intracellular and extracellular fluids. So the factor that shift the potassium into the cell and decrease extracellular potassium concentration, these are number one insulin, second aldosterone, and third is the beta adrenergic stimulation, and fourth one is the alkalosis. And the second column of this table show the factors that shift potassium out of the cell and increase cellular potassium concentration. These are the insulin deficiency, as in case of diabetes, aldosterone deficiency, especially in the Addison disease, beta adrenergic blockade, acidosis, cell lysis, strenuous exercise, and increased extracellular fluid osmolarity. I hope you will understand the distribution and redistribution of the potassium between the extracellular and the intracellular potassium. So, in overview of renal potassium excretion, renal potassium excretion that is determined by the three processes. Number one, the rate of potassium filtration, that is the potassium filtration, glomerular filtration rate, GFR, it is multiplied by the plasma potassium concentration. Second are the rate of potassium reabsorption by the tubules, and the third are the rate of potassium secretion by the tubules. So normal rate of the potassium by the glomerular capillaries is about 756 milliequivalent per day. If the GFR is 180 liter per day multiplied by the plasma potassium concentration, which is 4.2 milliequivalent. The rate of filtration is relatively constant in healthy person because of autoregulatory mechanisms for the GFR. So the GFR, certain renal diseases can cause serious potassium accumulation and the hyperkalemia will be there. So overview, you can see in this diagram summarize the tubular handling of the potassium under normal condition. About 65% of the filtered potassium is reabsorbed in the proximal tubule, you can see in this diagram. Another 25 to 30% of filtered potassium is reabsorbed in the loop of Hennel, especially in the thick ascending part of the loop of Hennel, where potassium is actively co-transported along with the sodium and chloride. In both the proximal tubule and loop of Hennel, a relatively constant fraction of the filtered potassium load is reabsorbed, and only the 12% that is excreted one. And by most of day-to-day variation of potassium excretion is not due to changes in the reabsorption in the proximal tubules or loop of Henle. This is also some potassium reabsorption in the collecting tubules and collecting duct. The amount reabsorbed in the part of nephron varies depending upon the potassium intake. So the potassium secretion by the principal cell of the late distal and collecting tubules. You can see in this figure that the potassium intake is low, secretion of potassium in the distal and collecting tubule decreases, causing a reduction in the urinary potassium level. The most important site for regulating excretion are the principal cell of the late distal tubule and the collecting tubules in these tubular segment. Potassium can at the time reabsorb or at about the time secreted depending on the need of the body. With normal potassium intake of 100 milliequivalent per day, the kidney must excrete 92 milliequivalent per day. The remaining 8 milliequivalent are lost in feces. So about 60 milliequivalent per day of potassium are secreted into the distal and collecting tubules, accounting for most of the excreted potassium. With high intake of the potassium, the required extracellular excretions, so the secretion of potassium from blood into the tubular lumen in two steps, beginning with uptake from the interstitium into the cells by sodium potassium ATPase pump. You can see in this figure the cell in the late distal and collecting tubules that secrete potassium are called principal cells. Showing in the figure, the secretion of potassium from blood in the tubular lumen in two processes, beginning with uptake from the interstitium into the cell by the sodium potassium pump in the basolateral cell membrane. This pump moves sodium out of the cell into the interstitium, at the same time move potassium to the interior of the cells. The second step of the process is passive diffusion of the potassium from the interior of cell into the tubular fluid. The sodium potassium ATPase pump create a high intracellular potassium concentration which provide the driving forces for passive diffusion of potassium cells into the tubular lumens. So there are two type of special channel that allow the potassium ions rapidly to diffuse across the membrane. These are, number one, the renal outer medullary potassium channel, and the high concentration, high conductance, big potassium channel. Both type of channels are required for efficient renal potassium excretion, and their excess in the luminal membrane is increased due to high potassium intake. So increased extracellular potassium concentration stimulate the potassium secretions. So in the graphical manners, the control of potassium secretions by the principal cells depend on the activity of sodium potassium ATPase pump and electrochemical gradient for potassium secretion from the blood to the tubular lumen and permeability of the luminal membrane for the potassium. These three determines the potassium secretion and in turn regulated by several factors. As you can see, the summary of factors that regulate the potassium, the effect of aldosterone and the ATPase pump. The effect of plasma aldosterone concentration and extracellular potassium ion concentration on the rate of urinary potassium excretion. These factors stimulate potassium secretion by the principal cell of the cortical collecting ducts